This is an A.J. Duggar exclusive.
Hey everybody, this is award-winning journalist A.J. Duggar here with Mr. Ross Hall, formerly of the Nickelodeon show Are You Afraid of Dark? Man, how you doing today?
I'm doing great, A.J., thanks.
Cool. Now, we have to start this thing off right. So, I'm going to try an introduction, then I'll let you try one. We'll let the fans pick which one was better, but I'm thinking of something like,
submitted for the approval of the Midnight Society. I call this story the tale of AJ's interview with that guy from that show.
Was that your voice?
Yeah, that was me. Yeah, I just...
Amazing. Wow. I don't know if I can compete with that baritone, to be honest. I can try. That was really good. Submitted for the approval of AJ's audience. I call this story... I hope AJ goes easy on me interview.
Yeah, no problem. We're going to have a deep Oprah Winfrey type of conversation here.
Yeah, just don't make me cry or anything. I don't want to jump in the campfire or anything.
Okay, man. So where are you from and how did you get into acting?
I'm originally from Montreal, Canada. For those not familiar with Canadian geography, it's basically in the eastern part of Canada, and our central eastern part. And in terms of how I got into acting, believe it or not, my mom got me into modeling. I was doing Zellers modeling catalogs and that kind of stuff, and that led to commercial auditions, and eventually led to a little later on in life television auditions. And in Montreal, I auditioned for the pilot of Are You Afraid of the Dark, and that led to eventually being on the TV show, which was also shot in Montreal. So I was lucky enough to be, a lot of people say to be at the right place at the right time. Well, I guess I was in the right city at the right time to be able to have an opportunity to do that show.
Cool. I always loved Are You Afraid of the Dark? I mean, I was scared of it when it first came out. I was like six. But, I watch it today. Me and my girlfriend watch it all the time on YouTube because it's like, I can respect it because I think Goosebumps was too kiddie. Are You Afraid of Dark? It was kiddie, but it was still a bit deeper. You know what I'm saying? And I also enjoy, you were my favorite character right off the bat because, around the time when the show came out, I became a big brother. So I related to you and Tucker,
Right.
And you had the glasses, you know what I'm saying? Back then I was somewhat of a bookish guy too, so I related to your character. And let me ask you this: was there any drama behind the scenes? Were there any hookups? Like, what were you guys like? Behind
It was pretty clean behind the scenes, I have to say. There was really nothing, no drama, that's for sure. We all got along really well. I think that when you have a group of kids, basically we were. It kind of ranged in age. Daniel was younger. I think he was 11 or 12 when Danny DeSanta, who plays Tucker, when we started the show. I was actually 18 when we actually started shooting the show. So I really wasn't a kid, but and basically ranging from 12 to 18 were the age ranges of the cast. So yeah, at times we did act like kids. Daniel would throw shrubs at me, and I would try to trip him in the woods and that kind of stuff. Because you kind of become, when you're in an environment where you're supposed to, because we were always playing younger than what we were, you kind of start acting like kids. But no, it was just, I think I look back at that experience and I think we all had a lot of respect for each other. It was pretty good experience, but nothing too controversial, I have to say.
Okay, so you guys were nothing like the cats to say about a bell or anything like that.
Not really. Maybe there was stuff going on that I wasn't in on. It's possible. I can't speak for everyone, but it certainly wasn't too crazy. We didn't really have time. Our schedule was pretty intense, and we couldn't really mess around too much. The producers made sure that we were on track for sure.
Okay. Now, a lot of your stories featured side dough, accent on the dough. And I put two and two together because there was an episode when Gary had somebody, I forget which girl it was, Kristen or Sam or somebody. He had her in his dad's magic shop. And
right.
The magic shop was the same magic shop that Sardo was in. So I got to ask you, was Sardo your dad or somebody that your dad inspired?
I know that's a good question. It's never specified. You're right. That episode was actually is Rachel Blanchard. It was Kristen.
Okay.
So that was one of the first times that was pretty cool because it was one of the first times that Gary was actually not a part of the, like he was in an episode and not a part of the campfire, if you recall, because that was the start of an episode.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the start of Superstar, I believe.
Right.
And you know, there's an interesting thing there too because they on that day. Gary's glasses were always in a you know, in his case, and every time, you know, we were finished the take, I'd give the glasses back so that they didn't get damaged or lost or anything. But if you notice in that episode, Gary's not wearing glasses in that scene.
Mm-hmm.
It's because, I think, from what I recall, they forgot to bring the glasses to the set to shoot that scene. So they just decided, you know what, it's fine, you just won't, you keep wearing contacts that day or something like that. And maybe they wanted it to look a little different, too, so that's why he's not wearing glasses. But in terms of your question, the connection to Sardo, you know, it was his father. There's mention of his father being into the occult and into those things in the show, I believe. But I don't know if Sardo was specifically his dad, but every time Sardo was in an episode, Gary was certainly connected, that's for sure.
Okay. Okay, and I got to ask you this about Sam, because you guys, you know, you guys had the crushes on each other. I got to ask, did Gary ever get the draws? Did he ever get it?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's one of those things where, you know, I think he really wanted it, and I think everything was sort of leading to that. But I think we'll have to leave it up to the imagination of viewers to see what happened.
Yeah, because it was leading up to it, like you say, but then all of a sudden they were both off the show and we never got any kind of closure. Cause I was rooting for Gary to succeed,
right.
You know?
Right. Yeah, well, I guess what happened is they decided to come back with another cast, right? Because that cast went to 65 episodes of my cast, and then they kind of did a reboot of the show with another cast, but then they kept Tucker, Daniel DeSantis' character, for the second season, and Gary actually did come back for an episode, a two-part episode in the second, cast. He did come back, but yeah, it kind of just ended. It didn't really. There was no real payoff, I guess, with that plot line. I agree.
Yeah, it was. I was disappointed. But I'm gonna get to the second series in a second. I gotta ask you a question about Tucker. I gotta ask a question about your brother Tucker too, because I'm talking to you. It's funny, I'm talking to you like you're Gary. Sorry. Was Tucker technically, was he like a half brother or a step brother? Because he looks, you know, Dominican or something. You know, people have been asking about that online. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Oh, like whether he was like, you know, within the show, you mean? Whether he was supposed to be like my real brother or half brother?
Right, yeah, if he was like a biological brother, because he looks, you know.
That's the interesting thing when you do shows like this. Sometimes those, you know, people come up with questions that you didn't even sort of fathom. I never even thought of that. I think it was always considered that he was my, you know, full brother. You know, it was never mentioned otherwise. I think that they probably cast him because he's a talented actor, and I think he did the role really well. He certainly did it in real life. He annoyed me in real life. He certainly did it on the show as well. I get annoyed in a really nice way, I think in a brotherly way. Yeah, that was never discussed. I mean, I think he had darker features, dark hair, dark eyes, and so did I. So I think those are probably the things, like, for television casting, I think those were the things that they tried to match up. And because his background is Italian.
Oh, okay. I was trying to figure out what he was.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and so what was your favorite story? What are your favorite episodes? Like your top favorite, you know, top three or so?
Yeah. It's hard to sort of, you know, people ask me this all the time, and I think that to try to come up with one episode is tough.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that any episode that, you know, it was always fun when Gary got to, you know, tell a story and you know, I think that any of the stories that Gary did tell with Stardew were awesome. So, you know, but to try to pick one particular episode, it's really tough.
Yeah, I understand that, yeah. Dude, I had quite a few favorites, man. There's so many. And one episode that's memorable, I remember pretty well, is the tale of the Captured Souls, because the kid in it, the kid that played that guy Peter, the creepy kid, he sounded just like Michael Jackson. He was like, "Hello, Danielle. I didn't mean to startle you."
Right.
Sounded just like the King of Pop. So, you know... And people watch it, they're gonna hear this interview and be like, he did sound like Michael Jackson. Damn.
Right.
Okay.
Was that the episode that scared you most?
I'm a Michael Jackson fan, so this kid was like,
right.
Would like to have some tea, Danielle? Like, he sounded just like him.
Right.
Okay, but let me ask you this. So why did the cast change so much during the show's original run? Because there were some characters that kind of just came and went. People kept moving away, and, you know, were people getting fired, or were there short contracts, or what?
That's a good question. I think it was basically a combination of a couple of things. Some actors, for instance, Jacob Tierney, he went on and he got a movie role, and he sort of, there were some other projects that he wanted to do. And then I think it was a certain situation where some people just didn't want to do acting anymore. Maybe, you know, they decided that, they wanted to sort of pursue other things, school, that sort of thing. I don't think it was ever a situation where someone was thrown off the show. I think it was just a combination of, you know what, I think this is best at this time. But there were certainly a lot of changes. You know, I actually sort of started rewatching a lot of the older episodes, and it sort of struck me when I started from the beginning and then went towards the end of the first 65, how much things changed. And I thought about that, and I thought about how that would be, for kids that are used, kids like, I don't know, I mean, kids can adapt to change. I mean, viewers can adapt to change, but I think that also kids get attached to certain characters, and they start, and so those changes might have been a little... disconcerting, I guess, but it seems like people still follow the new characters, and, I think it was also, whenever a new character was introduced, it was a fun way for the writers to do, to sort of go through the ceremonies of what happens, or the traditions of the Midnight Society, of how they inducted new members, and that sort of thing, so I think they had fun with it, with each new character, so hopefully it all worked out.
Okay. Oh, and you did ask me a second ago which one was scariest to me. Probably Tale of the Quicksilver, probably. It was so many great ones. Let me ask you, in 1996, when you guys stopped, and I know the show came back, I think 1999, what happened in 96? Were you canceled, or was everybody like, we've had a nice run, let's just do something else?
Well, from my understanding, television... We had reached 65 episodes. So in Canada, at that point, shows could reach syndication. So that's when they could take the show at 65 episodes. And, the Canadian distributors, and even I think the U.S. distributors and the international distributors could sort of, market it and sell it and all those things with that amount of episodes. So I think they kind of had, it was a critical mass time where they go, okay, well, we could do another season, or we could take this and sell it and, make more money off of it, I would assume. So I think that's why they sort of ended it at that point. My earbuds just fell out here. So I think that's the reason why they stopped at 65. Now as to why they rebooted it and started it again, so maybe they figured there was still an audience out there for it, and I think they went to...
Okay. Yeah, I like the second series. I mean, It wasn't bad, but I think it lacked the punch of the original, you know, series. But I was happy that they brought you back for the tale of the Silver Sight. I was like, yes, Gary's back. You know, it was like, it was a pretty good story too. Like, how did they get you back on board for that? Did they call you and like, hey, we want you to come back for this episode?
Yeah, I was pretty excited about it. I wasn't expecting it, but they called me and they asked me to, they wanted me to be a part of this episode. They wanted to bring Gary back, and I was you know, more than excited to come back and do it, to work with Daniel Santo, Tucker, and also to work with the new cast. I got to work with Alicia Cuthbert as well, and it was a great experience, and I think it was cool because it was more than just being around the campfire. It was very sort of, you know, I think everyone was involved in the episode. I think it was an opportunity for the Midnight Society, the new Midnight Society, to be a part of that episode too. But, you know, Gary was sort of a detective and taking control of certain things, and so yeah, it was a great experience.
Okay. I'm not gonna hold you too much long. I got two more questions. Do you still keep in touch with anybody else from the show?
Yeah, I keep in touch. I kept in touch with Daniel. I kept in touch with Graham Perry Cool, who played Betty Ann. Her and I worked at CBC, which is the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, the public broadcaster. We both worked there for she's worked there for longer than me, but I was there for a couple years. And here and there, I do keep in touch with other cast members. So yeah, but those are the two that I talk with most frequently. And I still keep in touch with DJ McHale. We message each other on Facebook once in a while. He's he's doing very well, and we sort of chat once in a while. So it's still a part of my life.
Okay. And last question is, and this is the $1 million question and the biggest question: what are you up to today? What are you doing?
Well, one aspect of what I'm doing today surprises many people. I'm actually a meteorologist, so I work at a local station here, and I do weather. And I've been doing weather actually in reporting the last 10 years or so. I went to Mississippi State University. We were talking about this before the interview, so I did a meteorology program there. I also did my undergrad at a university here in Toronto. But what I'm also working on is that I started up this YouTube project about a year ago, and it basically stems from the fact that, you know, why we're doing this interview, that the fact that sort of there's a lot of 90s nostalgia going on and people still remembering this show. So I figured originally a documentary, basically. Matthew Klickstein is an author who wrote a book called Slimed, which basically describes the what he calls the golden years of Nickelodeon in the 80s and 90s. And I went to the launch of that, and the book launch of that, and I met like hundreds of fans of Are You Afraid of the Dark? And, you know, it's basically that's the documentary. The second episode is going to be basically taking Gary back around the campfire and he tells a story of basically what it's like being a campfire kid in 2014. So it uses the campfire concept, but sort of brings it back to modern times, and we have a bit of fun with it, and I think it's really good. I think fans are going to like it, and it's just fun still. I think there's people are still wanting some of this content and wanting to connect with the show and my character and so on, so that's one of the reasons why I'm doing it, and it's kind of fun to be back and a creative cycle and doing these things. So I'm really excited about seeing what people are gonna, how people are gonna react to the second episode. I think that's an important point that you make, because that's what I've heard a lot about with talking to fans of the show and why there's still, you know, there's still this connection that they feel, and why they even watch the show, you know, again on YouTube and so on, is because, and I think I mentioned that book by Matthew Klickstein. He brings this up as well. I think that, you know, the writers of the show, that was what was different and special about Nickelodeon and Are You Afraid of the Dark, is that the writers of the show had a lot of respect for kids, for their viewers. You know, they didn't talk down to teens or, you know, the age range of the show watched the show back in the 90s, I think that they really felt like the show was talking to them. And I think that's why there was that connection. So I think that's what makes Are You Afraid of the Dark a different type of show, is that it, you know, it did insult the intelligence of their viewers. You know, it took it seriously, and you know, I think at times as well, I think the show, you know, it was a little scarier than maybe some other shows would have been for that age range. But I think that it also depended on parents. If it was a little too much for kids, then, you know, the parents would let them watch certain parts, or, you know, that sort of thing. So I just wanted to bring up at that point, because I think that, I think you picked up on it.
This is an AJ Duggar exclusive.